Good evening, and welcome to tonight's meeting of the Commonwealth Club of California, the place where you are in the know. Find us on the internet at commonwealthclub.org. I'm Mary Cranston, senior partner of Pillsbury, Winthrop, Shaw, Pittman, and your moderator for today's program. And it is now my great pleasure to introduce today's speaker, Elliot Spitzer. Governor Spitzer is a native New Yorker who served as the New York State Attorney General for 7 years and then as the 54th governor of New York. He's a graduate of Princeton and Harvard Law and has had a far-reaching career as an activist prosecutor. When only 2 years out of law school, he joined the Manhattan District Attorney's Office, where he launched the investigation that ultimately brought down the Gambino mafia family. Later, as Attorney General, he took on civil actions and criminal prosecutions relating to corporate white-collar crime, securities and internet fraud, and environmental protection. And he was the initiator of major investigations and prosecutions of investment bank with respect to stock price inflation and the predatory lending practices of mortgage lenders. Governor Spitzer was sworn in as governor of New York on January 1, 2007, a post he held until his resignation in March of 2008. Since then, Mr. Spitzer has drawn on many years of investigation and prosecution in the banking industry and has been commenting on the market failure of 2008 and the government response to the economic fallout. So please join me in welcoming Governor Spitzer to the podium of the Commonwealth Club.
Thank you so much for the introduction. Thank you for inviting me and hearing your lineup of speakers over the next couple days. I really am especially honored, and I have to say, hearing that John, you will be here makes me seem totally non-controversial. So this is, I will say that if you haven't, and Joe Stiglitz will say this himself, no doubt, or maybe he won't, if you haven't bought and read his book, you should do both. Actually, I don't care if you buy it, you should read it. He probably cares if you buy it, but it's important to read. It is a remarkable commentary on what we can and should learn from the economics of the past 2 years. I'm thrilled he's speaking in a few days from now, because if you had been here to hear him, then what I will make, the observations I'll make about the same topic would seem totally superficial, and so I'm glad to go first in this endeavor. I said to Mary, the art of being a politician is the art of being a dilettante. You know enough about many topics to sound knowledgeable, and you live in constant fear that people will realize you're not. So let me frame what I want to do in the following way. I want to sort of actually touch on three discrete areas that are all derivative of the crisis, the cataclysm of the last 2 years, coming at it from different perspectives. Hopefully the topics as I raise them will evoke questions, responses, thoughts on your part, because I think there's so much to learn from the last 2 years. And where I want to begin is that we need to view where we are today, where we are, the United States as an economy, as a nation, at some point from 10,000 feet, 30,000 feet, whatever elevation you want, we need to take a more global perspective. One of the realities of the moment is that our position in the world is fundamentally different than it was 2 years ago and certainly 45 years ago. And as we grasp and try desperately to maintain our place in the world of primacy, the Pax Americana, the sole superpower that we so proudly saw ourselves as after the fall of the Soviet Union, we need to realize that the fundamental comparative advantages that we have had vis-a-vis the rest of the world have changed dramatically. And the way I want you to think about this is that in 1945, at the end of World War II, the United States was the only nation in the world that had the following advantages: skilled labor, capital is in the form of money, intellectual capital in the sense of innovation that could drive an economy, the rule of law, and a government that would enforce that rule of law, and the innovative capacity to drive an economy. Every one of those, and those are the primary inputs that drove us from 1945 until the mid-80s, the mid-90s, at which point we finally woke up and said, wait a minute. If you have read, I don't know if you've read Francis Fukuyama's book, The End of History, or know of it. Francis Fukuyama, in that book, essentially argued that the United States had won the grand ideological debate of history. And that ideological debate had taken us to a point where democracy and tolerance and capitalism and the merger of those ideologies was accepted by everybody as the dominant and winning ideology. And hence, history in the sense of evolving ideologies had come to an end. Now, the irony for Fukuyama is, I think, and most people now think he was wrong. wrong in the sense that we have not won. We are battling something which is, in fact, quite dangerous now, and that's fundamentalism. Fundamentalism of many stripes and shades, but nonetheless fundamentalism that is a challenge to us. Put that aside, to a great extent, he was right. We had won the economic battle. Communist China, communist Soviet Union were now capitalist nations. India, I don't need to give you the litany of nations. The rest of the world had embraced our economic and political ideology, and hence, because we had won, we now needed to compete with them. And so when we move into the 90s and the most recent decade, we are facing a world where if you go back to that list of comparative advantages that we began with in 1945, skilled labor, virtually all of these major nations now have skilled labor, certainly cheaper labor. In terms of the cost of labor, we know we are at a significant disadvantage. In terms of capital, we are now the largest debtor nation in the world. In terms of innovation, we know that the creativity and the number of engineers being generated in China and India is beginning to match ours. Again, there are issues of counting, but they are beginning to move up dramatically in that score. In terms of the middle class market, and what drove our economy for so many decades was that we had the market. In other words, the U.S. consumer pulled the world economy forward. Today, we have flipped that on its head. It is the Asian consumer who is beginning to pull the economy out of this recession or depression that we've had. So and the rule of law. Now, granted, I think if you're an investor, there's still concerns whether in Venezuela you'll be able to recoup your investment in other nations as well. But certainly, we are now at a point in time where the rest of the world on each one of these critical issues has caught up to us, and so the comparative advantages that made it easy, not easy overstates it. I mean, Tom Brokaw would take offense. The greatest generation was the greatest generation. It did remarkable things. But nonetheless, our position in the world made it relatively easier to succeed than it does today, where the world is a much more competitive place. Now, what does that mean for us? What that means for us, given that capital is mobile, and, I rarely invoke Marx, and I'm a confirmed capitalist, and in case there's any doubt, he was right about one thing. Capital and labor are often in tension. Capital is much more mobile than labor. With the mobility of capital, its capacity to move around the world, labor has been at a distinct disadvantage over the last number of years, and that explains the fundamental redistribution of income that we are seeing in the United States. We all, I think, in this room appreciate the middle class median family income in the United States has not grown for 30 or 40 years. The income of those at the top 1%, 5%, you can measure it in different ways, has grown substantially. Why is that? It's partly as a consequence of political philosophies, which we can talk about in a few minutes, but it's also a consequence of the fact that with the mobility of capital, with the ability of corporate executives to invest overseas and drive return to capital up and return to labor down, we are seeing a redistribution. For many decades, we believed in the United States that we were building a society that looked like a bell curve, you know, the bell curve with most people congregated in the middle. Because today we have seen that middle class being pushed down, the metaphor I use is that we're looking more and more like a barbell, where we have a big bump at the bottom, a middle class that has been pushed, and then a smaller bulge at the top end. That is the reality of U.S. income distribution, and the reason for it is because of the convergence of all of these macroeconomic factors that give capital a distinct advantage, have disadvantaged labor, and have made it easier to get far returns that are ahistorical for capital that can invest in various parts of the world. Now, what does all that mean? You've read Tom Friedman's brilliant analysis, The World is Flat. If you have not read Fareed Zakaria's Post-American World, I recommend that as well. Fareed basically said, and he wrote his book before the cataclysm of the last 2 years, he said, look, things aren't so bad. There's probably going to be a lengthy period of 30 or 40 years during which time we will not be the unchallenged superpower, but we'll be doing okay. We will be the largest economy, we will be the most powerful military force, we will be the voice of tolerance and an ideology that we all embrace. So, you know, relax, we'll be okay. The last person I would challenge would be Fareed. He's both a brilliant writer and speaker and analyst. But I think what has happened is that this cataclysm of the last 2 years has compressed that 30-year span into 2 years or less. And this switch, this period where the fulcrum of the world, which is now China, we are now revolving around China in a much more fundamental way than we had expected. When you read the headlines day in and day out, you see that foreign policy discussions, the Japanese government, who are they beginning to get closer to? China. Where is capital being invested and by whom? China is buying up the natural resources around the world, something we used to do while we're paying for soldiers in Afghanistan. China now sells and buys more cars every month than the United States. Their middle class market is larger than ours. They're beginning to make inroads in what had been the last remaining sectors where we had substantial export opportunities. Aerospace. There's a little blurb in the FT months ago now, about a year ago, that Goldman was investing with CACC in China's sovereign wealth company that was going to start producing mid-sized aircrafts. Now, why is that important? Because that is, you know, Boeing is really one of the few major successful exporters we have these days, and what they're doing with aerospace is equivalent to what Toyota did with cars 50 years ago. Moreover, what is going to be the largest market for airplanes over the next 50 years? Asia. So they will have a homegrown sector that will sell to its home populations, home countries, and we will be squeezed out. So these are all terribly difficult challenges, which then takes me to the bottom line on this little piece of it. We need a government at this moment that is nimble, quick, can respond, and make smart investment decisions. Unfortunately, this is the very moment where our government is failing us. And I stand here as somebody who has been part of that governmental process for the last 10 years. By the way, you shortchanged me 1 year in Attorney General. I was Attorney General for 8 years. So that's all right. You know, I'm a stickler for things like that. But while I was Attorney General, I didn't need to get involved in the budgetary and allocation decisions you do when you're a governor or president or whatever. But our governments are failing us. When you're in New York, we write all the time and talk all the time about how Albany is the most dysfunctional state government in America. When you're in New Jersey, you talk about Trenton. When you're in California, you talk about Sacramento. This is not something that is unique to any one state. Now, I've said, and I don't say this defensively or to sort of protect my former colleagues who are governors, being governor may be the most difficult job in America right now because you have revenues that are declining by 15 or 20%. Everybody still wants their local schools to be funded the same level they were the year before. You still have to invest in roads. You still have to pay for health care, et cetera, et cetera. So when you're dealing with a negative sum game in terms of budgeting, it's almost impossible. But even the federal government that has the distinct advantage of being able to print money, and that's a nice thing to be able to do, let me tell you, governors go to bed every night saying, I wish I had a printing press. I wish I could get that printing press going. Even the federal government is finding it incapable to deal with these significant issues. I don't know if you've seen, it's on the wires late this afternoon, that healthcare is basically off the domestic agenda. They've pulled the cord, they've said, we're not going to get it done. You know, this is a momentary hiatus, but that means it's done for who knows how long. So in a way, and I don't say this critically of the president, but I think you can almost look at the past year and capture it as the year of the incredible shrinking presidency. I mean, what have we actually been able to do? The answer is virtually nothing. And so our governments are failing us at the very moment when we need to be very smart to build what I think we have all now come to call the innovation economy, where we can at least keep that engine of innovation moving forward so we can compete on the global stage. All right, that's chapter one, because I think it's important to get that macro image of where we are. Issue two is an effort to answer the question, what should government do? And boy, that sounds pretty wide open and dramatic, but here's the reason I keep coming back to this question. We have gone in the past 2 years from an avowed allegiance, not I, but those who are in the senior levels of government, allegiance to Ayn Rand libertarianism, which if you read Alan Greenspan's autobiography, and I read it with shock because I said, my goodness, this guy was chairman of the Fed. That's supposed to be a regulatory interventionist position. This guy is singing the praises of Ayn Rand left, right, and center. But that was the accepted dogma. Began with the election of President Reagan, and it dominated the intellectual discourse of the country from that moment until a year ago. We've gone from Ayn Rand libertarianism to having Ken Feinberg appointed to set the salaries of senior executives at companies across the board. How did we span that spectrum so quickly? How do you go from one intellectual extreme to the other? And does that mean that there are no real intellectual moorings? And can we construct some meaningful set of principles that will permit us to understand what government should do and why? Because if we can't do that, then we'll be just coming up with ad hoc decisions without any coherent argument. And so we need to try to do it. Interestingly, when I was Attorney General, and we were an activist office, we did all sorts of stuff that got people really upset. We used to enjoy it. I won't deny that now. I have no reason to. And sometimes they were upset legitimately. You know, we were always right, needless to say. But I could understand why that got upset. But thinking about these issues when I was Attorney General, I said, what are the parameters? What are the principles that should guide government intervention? And I've come up with a sort of a set of rules. And parenthetically, the reason we need these rules is because, as I've said, angry populism isn't a theory of government. Angry populism doesn't, at the end of the day, give us a structure that permits us to move forward. It's fun, feels good. You know, let me tell you, screaming from the top of the ramparts, you know, it's good cardio workout, and it also makes us, you know, it's cathartic, but it doesn't, in the long run, succeed in giving us answers. So what are the principles? Rule number one is that only government can ensure integrity in the marketplace. Now, that sounds like such an obvious, blasé statement, but nobody believed it 3, 4, 5 years ago. There was this canard, this oxymoron that we called self-regulation. Self-regulation, you know, look, we can all sit here and roll our eyes. That was the governing ideology for a long time. And when I would go down to Washington and we'd bring our cases and I would say self-regulation doesn't work and this and that, people would say, oh, come on, you're just, you know, some leftover from the 60s. Yeah, I was only born in 59. But people, this was a very difficult fight. And the story I tell that sort of explains, at least it brought it home to me, was it came out of the first case we made. It was a case against a major investment bank, Merrill Lynch, and had to do with the tension that existed between underwriting IPOs and secondary offerings on the one hand, and also having analysts simultaneously recommend those stocks to the investing public, which is a conflict of interest. And although this also, Jack Grubman, whose name you may remember, one of the analysts who was involved in all this, captured the moment in time when he said what used to be viewed as a conflict of interest is now viewed as a synergy. But again, he was right. I mean, it was one of those great linguistic, you know, changes. You call it a synergy, it sounds, oh, that sounds good, it sounds clever and sophisticated, we'll do an IPO and everybody will come out ahead. You know, it was a conflict of interest, but what happened in this case, we got all these emails together and we read them and it took a lot of time and most of the time it was boring beyond words, but we found the needles in the haystacks and we made our case. And we were about to file the case, and my first introduction to this type of litigation came when the lawyer for Merrill called me up and said, Elliot, I'm warning you, we have powerful friends. And I said, well, that's an interesting legal argument. I've never, they didn't teach me that one in law school. What am I supposed to say? And, you know, I was younger. I puffed out my chest and said, well, I'll show you who has powerful friends. You know, maybe at the end of the day he won, but that's a separate issue. Nonetheless, we move forward and we file the case, and Merrill comes in with its bevy of lawyers from a firm I'd actually practiced at. They're, needless to say, then good lawyers. And I'd been on the other side of the aisle. I'd been a white-collar defense lawyer for a period of time, so I knew the litany of arguments you made. A, you don't understand the emails. B, you took them out of context. 3, the person who wrote them wasn't authorized to say that. D, you know, then you start checking your liability insurance. You start doing all sorts of things. But they didn't do that. They came in and they said, Elliot, you're right. You're absolutely right. But we're not as bad as our competitors. And that was their defense. And I said to them, you know, that's clever. I know we're living in a world of moral relativism, and that's wonderful. But when I used to prosecute, you know, regular, ordinary crimes, if somebody was indicted for 5 robberies, it wasn't a successful defense to say, yeah, but that guy over there did 10. It doesn't matter. But the point was this. When it came to a choice between behavior that they knew was problematic, because they were recommending stocks where they knew they didn't believe these stocks were good, sacrificing that integrity versus market share, they sacrificed integrity. And I'm not saying this to say they were bad people. I mean, trust me, there's enough judging that goes on out there. The reality was the marketplace drove behavior down to a standard that was simply unacceptable. And the only entity that could come in and say, stop, that's not acceptable, was government. This is clear as day, and we should now accept that. So only government can do this. The footnote to Rule 1 is that we believe in competition. You know, let me say this. Everybody wants to be a monopolist. I don't care what they tell you. And I wouldn't want to invest with anybody who didn't want to be a monopolist, right? I mean, that's the drive to get to market share that gives you monopoly power. Only government can stop monopoly, exercise of monopoly power, and create competition. And competition is what makes the world go round. And so you need government to do those things, right? Second argument, and these are critically important arguments. Do I have 10 more minutes?
Yep.
10 more minutes, all right. Second argument is a little turgid, and if you haven't taken an economics course, I apologize, but it relates to externalities. And I guarantee you that Joe Stiglitz will mention this a couple of days from now. If we don't let government intervene to measure externalities and adjust the marketplace accordingly, all sorts of bad things will happen. And the example I use for this is environmental litigation. We brought a case when I was AG against a bunch of Midwestern utilities that were sending fumes up into the air. I went down to Washington to testify about it. Senator Voinovich, a very decent guy who had been the governor of Ohio, looked down at me from the dais and he said, "General Spitzer, I was governor of Ohio. I cleaned up the air in Ohio. Why are you suing my companies?" And I said, "Well, Senator Voinovich, Governor Voinovich, I applaud you for cleaning up the air in Ohio, but do you remember how you did it? You did it by building smokestacks that were 1,000 feet tall at your power plants. Now, you didn't do that because it was either cheap to do it or because they were pretty. You did it because when you build a smokestack 1,000 feet tall, the emissions, the CO2 that generate acid rain and the sulfur and all the other stuff, global warming, all that bad stuff, goes up into the jet stream, and it doesn't come down in Ohio. It doesn't even come down in Pennsylvania. I would have let you alone if it came down in Pennsylvania. Certainly, if it came down in Jersey, that would have been fine. And I shouldn't say that. John Corzine was a great governor, and it's too bad he got voted out. But those emissions come down in New York, and therefore I'm going to sue you. Because this is an externality. In other words, when they generate power and price that power for the residents of Ohio, what they don't measure is the negative cost, the real cost, to people who are not party to that private transaction. And that's what an externality is, a cost or a benefit that is not measured in the pricing between two private parties to a transaction. So government needs to measure it. The other example of this, and this is one people haven't thought about or hasn't been phrased this way, is debt, systemic risk. What is systemic risk? Systemic risk is sort of the metastasized impact of all the debt out there in society. Individual transactions may look okay. Any one in and of itself might be fine, but when you aggregate it all, something that the individual participants won't see, suddenly you've got this debt overhang, these leverage ratios that don't make sense. Somebody's got to control it. That's what systemic risk is. So think of systemic risk and the need for government to regulate it as being an enormous negative externality that the Fed should have been looking at. Of course, they weren't, but that's a separate issue. So externalities is the second critical reason that government has to intervene. The third, and again, the reason I'm going through this is I'm trying to begin a conversation about what government should do. Because if we don't do that, if we don't move forward that way, then this entire exercise will have been for nothing. The third argument, and I acknowledge it's the most elastic, and the way I capture it is core values. There are simply certain core values that define us as a society, as a community, which the marketplace will not accomplish. And I'll give you two examples. One of them is discrimination. And when I was an undergrad at Princeton, we did what we called a policy conference on discrimination. And the free marketeers, even back then, said, discriminating is inefficient. If I'm running a restaurant and I will not serve individuals who are over 6 feet tall, I will lose market share, I will be less efficient, capital will not come to my business, I'll go out of business. And therefore, the marketplace will deal with discrimination, whether it's on height, race, gender, whatever it may be. The problem is, they're wrong. The social mores that empower people and drive people to discriminate override rational economic behavior. And we saw this, that's why the rise of what we call behavioral economics. Behavioral economics finally is the awakening of economists to the fact that we aren't these purely autonomous, you know, sort of rational individuals who think only in numbers. We make all sorts of other value judgments. One of them was discrimination. Only when we passed a law that said discriminating based on race, gender, whatever, is illegal and gave people a remedy did we begin to confront that problem. Another core value that I'd give you an example of is minimum wage. There would not be a wage for low-wage workers that would be acceptable in most of our minds, I think, if we had not passed a minimum wage, even though it is an intervention in the marketplace that defies pure intersection of supply and demand. So core values is what I consider the third critical argument for government intervention. Now, I would suggest, I hope a lot of very smart people will say, no, you're wrong about this, or here's a fourth or a fifth or a sixth rule, but I think we need to begin to understand where we intervene and why, and leave to private actors that which private actors can properly do, but understand that government intervention in other areas is important. Take infrastructure. Why do we invest in infrastructure? Why does government do it? The enormous positive externality of building a mass transit system. or a public good such as defense, which is the economist's favorite example, certain things that only can be accomplished through government. This is how we should think about it, and I think if we do this, we can come up with an intellectual argument that creates a new foundation for what government can and should do. All right, third topic. Let me deal with this one kind of quickly, because I do want to have a conversation. The third issue is, how have we dealt with the crisis of the last 2 years? Have we done well? Have we not done well? I mean, I would give us, I now teach at CCNY, as Mary said. I think I was a pretty lenient grader, but I would give us about a C minus or a D based on how we have reacted to the crisis of the last 2 years. Take as your baseline proposition, we knew we were going to invest a lot of money and bail out the banks. That had to be done. That was reflexive. It was intuitive. We couldn't let them all go bust. You just couldn't do it. The economy would have come to a screaming halt. Now, that doesn't mean we couldn't have driven their share value to zero. We needed to go and then give them all these guarantees. We needed to give them TARP money. We needed to guarantee their issuance of commercial paper. All that stuff had to be done. The three critical questions that follow, though: one, who paid for it? Obviously, taxpayers were going to pay for some of it, but did we exact enough of a price from CEOs and those who had benefited from the prior years of improper behavior? And there the answer is clearly no. I don't say this to be mean-spirited, nasty, or punitive. It's simply that the profits that they claimed that generated these bonuses were illusory. It was, the words Ponzi scheme have sort of a negative connotation to them, but it was pretty darn close. You know, this was all, and I testified down in Washington a bunch of times, and everybody has now diagnosed it, that daisy chain of origination to securitization to credit agency ratings, slapping a AAA on everything, to then the banks selling it off into the marketplace, when we knew that these loans were not going to be repaid, was a scam. It was a scam, and those who benefited from it should have been forced to contribute and give back something more, even if only so the moral statement could be made, those who benefit should not escape scot-free. And so we have not done well in terms of allocating the burden of the bailout, and that is question one. Question two is, are we putting in place the meaningful reforms that will help us and prevent this from happening again? And there I think we are failing in a very fundamental way. Until very recently, and perhaps last week, with what we would call the Volcker Rule, what we had been seeing in terms of restructuring of financial services was essentially meaningless. What we were doing was what I call the regulatory charade. What do I mean by that? After a crisis of this sort, and it doesn't matter whether it was the Enron crisis, which generated Sarbanes-Oxley, or others, there is always the rush to pass a law. Why do we want to pass a law? The virtue to passing a new law is that the malefactors in the private sector get to say, go pay attention to passing a new law, don't worry about prosecuting us. The regulators who should have done something can stand up and say, we would have stopped it, but we didn't have the power, so pass a new law to give us the power, and then it won't happen next time. This is all a charade, because the reality is the regulators had the power, they just chose not to use it, and the people who were doing bad things should have been prosecuted. What we should have been doing is actually using the power that we had. Think of it this way. Over the past year and a half, the Fed, Treasury, OCC, others have done an amazing number of things. They haven't been granted new power to do it. They've been using the power they always had but never called upon. Why didn't they call upon it? Ideologically, they didn't want to. Now, does that make them bad people? No, I'm not saying they're all bad people, but the worldview at that time was simply not to intervene in the marketplace. And I'll give you an example of personal experience. We tried to investigate subprime lending back when I was AG. We went and served subpoenas. We wanted to gather the data. I'd written an article in the New Republic in 04 saying, it was just a throwaway line, but it said, this debt's not going to be repaid. This is bad stuff. The OCC and the banks went to court to stop us from serving the subpoenas and getting the information. They said, you're preempted. This, we could have a long, boring conversation about federalism. I won't go down that path. But we had to litigate this all the way to the United States Supreme Court to get the power to actually ask the questions to get the information. But worse of all, it's not as though the OCC and the other federal agencies said, you stop, we are doing it. They just said, you stop. Nobody was doing it. So the agencies that had the power simply didn't use it, and this cataclysm grew and grew and grew, and it ultimately collapsed. The other part of this, my critique of what I call the reform agenda, is what I call the Peter Principle on steroids. And we all know the Peter Principle, where people are promoted to their point of incompetence, and then they end there. What's happened in Washington is the people are promoted to the point of incompetence, and this sounds harsh, and I don't want to speak that ill of well-meaning people, but they're promoted, but I will. But they're promoted to the point of their incompetence. Because of that incompetence, a huge crisis erupts, and they then use the crisis to argue to be given even more power. So it's bad enough in the Peter Principle you stop here. Now they're saying because they stop here and fail, they get more power. And if you look at who is now in charge, it is basically the very people who were in charge of the Fed, in charge of the Treasury, in charge of the OCC, in charge of OTS, in charge of the FDIC, throughout the period that this crisis was brewing. There has been absolutely no accountability in terms of regulatory survival, in terms of who is there and who is not there. Now, again, I'm not saying these are bad people. They were wrong. They embraced an ideology that was simply wrongheaded. There were lots of people, Joe Stiglitz front and center among them, Paul Krugman, Rob Johnson, a lot of people who were saying all the way through this crisis, stop, this is dangerous. But the people who were fully invested in the Ayn Rand world are now still sitting at the top of the regulatory pyramid, and that worries me enormously. The only good news is in the past couple of days, Paul Volcker has reemerged, and I think he is one of the great thinkers and leaders in the financial services arena. He made us all suffer terribly in the 70s when he drove interest rates way to the top. He ground inflation out of our economy. But he has proposed that we go back to, the banks should go back to doing what banks are supposed to do, lending, and eliminate the proprietary trading, the gamesmanship of the razzle-dazzle. Banking should be boring. I hate to say it. Anybody who wants to go into banking, you should be bored to tears day in, day out. You should be looking at mind-numbing numbers saying, is this person going to repay his debt? Instead of saying, if I lend it to you, I'll get a fee, I'll securitize it, boy, I'll get my bonus checked, wow, my fifth BMW, my third yacht, everything's good. You know, this banking should be boring. We've got to redefine what banks do, in particular when we give them access to the federal guarantees. This notion that we made everybody a bank holding company so they could get access to the Fed window and give them money for free, they then go out and do the razzle-dazzle games, buy T-bills at 3, leverage up and get a 20% return, and they're not lending to the small, mid-sized companies to generate jobs. It's a horror show. That is why the economy is stalling. Paul Volcker is the one who is finally getting traction inside the White House, and I hope they begin to listen to him, and Elizabeth Warren, who's also one of the great voices out there. Anyway, last point. Third issue which we must confront in terms of the economic cataclysm, and that is jobs. And this is, at the end of the day, the bottom line issue that will define success or failure for us as an economy. And as we all know, we're not making any real success there. We're not making any headway. This is where, to a certain extent, the issue cycles back to the very first issue that I raised, which is the capacity of capital to, because it's so mobile, and that's a good thing, but because it's mobile, capital is flowing elsewhere. The economies that are booming, China growing at a 9% GDP growth, the rest of Asia a bit slower, but if you go to Vietnam, if you go to India, you see economies that are booming beyond words, and that's where capital is flowing, and the top tier here that controls capital and technology is doing very well. The other 95% of our country that needs the sort of typical, what we used to call blue-collar jobs to survive, is suffering. If you look at the number of manufacturing jobs in our economy, it has declined every month for the last decade, through good times and bad. This is a very difficult trend line to counteract, and we cannot all be lawyers and investment bankers. We cannot all work for hospitals and schools. At the end of the day, that economy doesn't add up. And so that is the conundrum that is incredibly difficult that we have to confront. Is it going to require currency revaluations, which we're not any longer in a position to demand of China? Perhaps they'll say, fine, we won't buy your T-bills. Good luck. We'll see you next year. Things are difficult. If you wonder why President Obama's journey to China a couple months ago looked the way it did, it's because when a kid goes to his parents and asks for allowance, that's what it looks like. And that is, unfortunately, this is the reality we're living in. And so we'd better think long and hard about where our economy is going to take us. So look, if I had to, I don't say this just because I'm here in San Francisco, we're close to Silicon Valley, right? All right, now I'm a New Yorker, so I don't know these things. But we need more Silicon Valleys. We need more creativity. We need more engineers. I'm sorry, Mary, you and I are both lawyers. We need fewer lawyers. We need more people who will actually create things of value so that those things of value can be produced here. One footnote to that, the iPod, which probably, there are 200 people in the room, we've all bought 5,000 iPods. The iPod is made in China. So even there, the benefits that accrue, yes, Apple is an amazing company, and Steve Jobs is a remarkable individual. And parenthetically, if you haven't read graduation speech. Was it commencement? Was it at Stanford? No, it wasn't Stanford. It was some, read it, one of the great speeches ever given. But where was it? Wasn't Harvard. No, it wasn't Harvard. I'd claim it if I could. Get that and read that. Even with the iPod, most of the benefit, or a fair bit of it, goes overseas because that's where the manufacturing is done. So even innovation will not give us the benefits and returns we need, but at least that is where we have to go. So anyway, let me stop there. I appreciate your invitation. Thank you much for your patience, and we'll try to answer some questions. So thank you.
Our thanks to Elliot Spitzer, former governor and attorney general for the state of New York, for those remarks. It's now time for the audience question period, and I have, as you can see, many questions have come up. So let's.
Do I get to pick or do you?
No, I get to pick. You commented on the financial failures and a number of reasons, but there's a couple of questions here about your views on how much of the situation was caused by actual and direct fraud, and how much is a lack of accountability on the part of corporate CEOs in this whole mess?
Okay, I'm not sure I would see those as the either or. I'm not sure that's the dichotomy. It's not lack of corporate accountability or
these
fraud.
These are just two questions.
Right, no, okay. I think the way I would frame the question, and it's a wonderful question, is how much was fraud and how much was simply being wrong? And that I think is the more important distinction. I always said, when we come back to the analyst case that we made, being wrong is not a crime, lying is a crime. So when analysts knowingly misled an investor and said, buy this, it's a great investment, and they knew it was going to go to zero the next day, that's a crime. If they recommended it and they were simply wrong, that's life. We all take risks. So I think the question is, how much was of this was simply everybody buying into an ideology of leverage and a euphoria that was simply misplaced, and how much of it was outright fraud? There is some element of fraud, and those cases will and should be prosecuted, but frankly, I think that was the minority position. I think that there was just this unbelievable embrace of an acceptance of leverage and certain principles of economics that self-regulation will work, where people were just fundamentally wrong. And if you want to read a brilliant book that captures it, read Galbraith's A Short History of Financial Euphoria. It really is, and it was written after the 87 crash. You will think you're reading something written after this crash. He diagnoses it perfectly. And it's just eerie, because if everybody had read that back in 2001, 2002, maybe this wouldn't have happened. The other book to read is his book about the 29 crash, where he kind of remarkably has a special chapter dedicated to Goldman Sachs and the role of Goldman in the 29 crash, and also has a chapter at the very end about causative factors that's identical to this. So the point is, history repeats itself. We delude ourselves into the alchemy of the moment, believing that we have figured out how to over-leverage and overborrow, and it never works. And so we're doomed to this, but that's where the role of regulators comes in, and that's why Tim Geithner, who utterly failed, utterly, utterly, utterly failed when he was president of the New York Fed, should have stepped in and said, stop, this doesn't work.
You know, you did make some comments about the bailout of major companies, and I think you commented on the fact that perhaps the repayment has not been as aggressive as it should have been, at least out of the hides of the CEO and some of the company executives. But I was wondering, in hindsight, what your views would be about what companies are too big to fail. What rules of the road would you have going forward in a similar situation?
Well, look, I'm not going to pretend I can define for you what too big to fail is, but I did write, look, I too big to fail is a theory we have to get rid of. In other words, too big to fail, so we permit them to grow so they get a federal guarantee. That's what led to the whole asymmetry. If you essentially socialize risk and privatize gain, you will get distorted investment strategies, and that's what we did. So we have to somehow scale back these companies. The Volcker rule is the first step, at least take away the federal guarantee for proprietary trading, the riskier types of private equity investments that are not core to what bankers should be doing. How do you then begin to whittle them down? That is a more complicated regulatory process, but it can be done. Some of the mergers that we approved over the last 5-10 years simply shouldn't have been permitted. We now have greater concentration of assets, greater concentration of deposits. Those things should go in the other way, both because competition works and because we can reduce the risk to the entire economy. So there are ways to do it. Defining what is too big is a dicey proposition.
One point you made briefly was that the government needs, or actually was one of your key points, the government needs to step in because there are certain things that the self-interest of the capital market will not attend to. But you've also made a number of comments about the Peter principle and how it applies to various people in the government today. And I wondered if you could sort of talk about that tension and what you would do about that.
Well, look, self-interest is good. I mean, I don't want to be Gordon Gekko up here, but you know, you just need to understand it. Now, there's understand that the fallacy was believing that self-interest was equated with the public interest. In other words, the fallacy behind so much of Ayn Rand and what Alan Greenspan did was believing that left alone, this convergence of private interests would necessarily create a publicly optimal outcome. You need to understand what private interest is and when it will drive behavior to be either improper ethically, as in the example of Merrill and the analysts, or improper from an economic perspective with the externalities, or just creating too much debt. So that is where you need to surround an understanding of private behavior with a more subtle, nuanced view of how they intersect, and that's what was missing with Greenspan and his entire ideological world.
You've commented on a couple of Obama's economic team. Could you give us an overview of your assessment of how they're doing in general? And then, in particular, would you give Bernanke a second term?
Boy, look, this is I went to Princeton. I should be loyal to Professor and Chairman Bernanke. The answer is no, I would not. And it's not because he is not an incredibly talented, smart, wise individual of absolute integrity. This has nothing to do with integrity. It has nothing to do with his not being a good, superb person. It has to do with the fact that he was and continues to be too intellectually invested in a Wall Street view of financialized economy that has taken us to a very bad place. I cannot believe that there are not other people in the United States, smart economists, who can handle the monetary obligations of being chairwoman of the Fed and simultaneously understand what should be done, whether it's Elizabeth Warren, whether it's Paul Volcker, whether he would want to, whether it's Paul Krugman, whether it is Joe Stiglitz. There are people out there who were right in diagnosing what was going on, and I don't think it's any slight to say, would you go back to the doctor who misdiagnosed your malady over and over and over again on the theory that maybe he learned? No, you'd go to the doctor who got it right. And I think that's what this is all about.
You're listening to the Commonwealth Club of California radio program, and our guest today is Elliot Spitzer, former governor and attorney general for the state of New York. There have been a number of questions about your comment on expanding the manufacturing sector and building blue-collar jobs, and the questions relate to how that can be done in a global economy where labor costs abroad are cheaper, and how can we do that and remain competitive in the international marketplace?
Okay. As I said, I ended there. I said that's the grand conundrum, and so there is no easy answer, and I'm not sure I have anything that is going to sound more than pablum, but here's what I would say. One, we need to fight harder on currency issues. I don't think there's any question that there is currency manipulation out there in the rest of the world that is designed to make other countries' manufacturing unfairly competitive, and that is an issue that has to be dealt with at the governmental level. Second, I think it is fair to say that to the extent that our businesses accept and internalize costs in terms of environmental policies and social policies that force them to absorb costs that other nations don't impose upon their workers, we should, in our trade treaties, be permitted to make some calibration as a consequence of that. That is the difference between complete free and unfettered trade and fair trade. Fair trade means that if we are doing what is smart and what is necessary from an environmental perspective, then we should not disadvantage our homegrown manufacturing as a consequence. Now, whether that would be sufficient to overcome it, I don't know. The other thing I would say, and this is where it gets a little mushy, I think we need to recognize that, and here I'm going to throw out a theoretical issue, the notion of what fiduciary duty means needs to be thought through very carefully. fiduciary duty has been interpreted as meaning maximizing shareholder value. Maximizing shareholder value means that, therefore, if you can move capital somewhere else in the world and increase the return to that share, regardless of the impact on the workers, the community, et cetera, you do it. I think we maybe need to rethink that, because in a world where capital is so mobile, embracing that notion of fiduciary obligation means that we're going to fundamentally destroy the guts of our economy. And maybe if we say to a company, you get the protection of the United States of America, your investors are here, we provide all sorts of benefits to you, you have some obligation to invest here. This is not some Luddite view that's going to cut trade, but I just think it's a more realistic understanding of what trade should be.
There are several questions on the recent Supreme Court decision with respect to corporate funds for campaigns, and I wondered what your reaction to that decision was.
Here I'm going to surprise you. I'm not persuaded that they didn't get it right, and here's why. I think that the decision has been, to a certain extent, misunderstood. This had nothing to do with corporate contributions to candidates. Those have been illegal and should be illegal. This had to do only with corporate speech that was independent of a political campaign. Now, the question I would ask you is, do you believe the New York Times editorial page should be permitted to endorse a candidate? Do you believe Rachel Maddow should be able to go on air and essentially endorse a candidate? The answer is, of course. That is corporate speech. That is not in any meaningful way that I can discern different from what was at stake and what was the factual foundation for the case, which was the Hillary movie, which was a spiteful, mean-spirited, ugly little diatribe funded with corporate dollars. But that is irrelevant to the constitutional issue. This was an issue of whether a corporation should be able to articulate its views in that way. And until somebody tells me that there's a difference, whether it's Bill O'Reilly, Rachel Maddow, the New York Times editorial page, and this movie, if we want to eliminate all of those, that is completely inconsistent with, I'm close to a First Amendment absolutist. I think it is what makes us different. It's what saves us. It's the core of our freedom. I don't see how we can begin to go down that path. And yes, does that create problems in terms of empowering people with loads of money to put up lots of ads? Yes, and we have to think about that. But the answer to speech is not to limit it. The answer to speech of one sort is to counter it with speech of another sort. I've always believed that, and I think that's how we should look at it.
You began your comments talking about how the economy of the globe is starting to revolve around China as opposed to the United States, and I wondered what you thought about some of the issues that exist in China with respect to investment, including the lack of a trusted legal system and the government that has somewhat idiosyncratic views on what they own and what they don't own and what they can do at any given time. What do you think that will do to China's taking a leadership position in the global economy?
Well, let me hedge on this only because I don't have enough information to give you a really meaningful answer. I think, remember, at the very beginning I said, it listed a bunch of metrics and said, along a bunch of these different axes, we are no longer so far ahead of the rest of the world, and one of them was the rule of law. Compared to 1945, where there was virtually no foreign investment in China, if any, one of the reasons being it was communist government, another reason being if you invested there, you had no confidence you could ever get your dollars back. They've certainly gone a long way since then, and they've gone a long way because they understand that in order to induce the flow of capital into the country, they need to create a rule of law. Venezuela is not going to be where people are as likely to put money when things are being nationalized left, right, and center. So people are going to go to other countries, whether it is China, where I think there is a fair degree of comfort that if you know the right people and you handle things the right way, you can protect your investment. And so I think if you read the FT, which is, I'm not here to plug anything, but it certainly I think is the best newspaper in terms of international business, you will see how much of the global economy now revolves around China's investment patterns, China's consumer demand, and the growth that China is generating. China is pulling the world out of this recession, not the United States. And that is a fundamental power shift that we have to come to grips with.
With the huge power of special interest groups in Washington and the actions of the government, which you have been somewhat critical of this evening, do you think there is any hope that we could get this right in the next 5 years?
Oh, look, there's always hope. I mean, one of the things, I think we are an overwhelmingly optimistic nation, and I don't mean to, again, reduce myself to political pablum, but it's true. We always, I'm going to root for the Giants next year because they're going to win the Super Bowl. I mean, things that completely defy, logic, you continue to believe. We are going to somehow muddle through. I think, has our government process gotten to the point where it gets harder and harder to believe we'll get there? Yes. There's another brilliant book you should read by Manker Olson called The Rise and Decline of Nations. It's about how special interests essentially, the best metaphor would be to arteriosclerosis. They just gum up the arteries of democracy to the point where decisions can't be made. And I think we are at that point. Remember the saying, a crisis is a terrible thing to waste. We are wasting this crisis because we haven't managed to overcome the latent opposition to the fundamental change we need to get things moving the right way. And his book, again, written several decades ago, captures that in a really brilliant way. So yes, we'll get it right, but it's going to require a lot more leadership than we've seen, a lot more. And I wrote a little thing in Slate, posted on Slate yesterday, I guess, where I said that we need President Obama to be a combination of FDR and Lyndon Johnson right now. He needs to have the imagery of FDR, but the head, arm-twisting capacity of Lyndon Johnson to get it done. There simply hasn't been that capacity to overwhelm the latent opposition of interest groups.
I have a number of questions around your resignation as governor of New York, and obviously it was a difficult circumstance. You were not the first politician to be in that set of circumstances, and the question I would ask you is, what advice would you have to young people considering political careers about how to make sure that their political career goes smoothly?
Well, look, I'm not sure I'm the one to give advice. Let me say this, and I mean this at one level very seriously. Politics is a noble endeavor, and despite all the cynicism that relates to politics and the failures of politics, most people who go into it for, of course, mixed motives. It's fun. There's an egotistical piece to it. But they want to do something that helps. And so I encourage people to get involved in politics. It doesn't mean electoral politics necessarily, but get involved. It really is what makes government work. We need to get more and better people into it. We saw Conan O'Brien's closing remarks when he signed off on NBC. I thought they were really quite remarkable. He said, cynicism gets us nowhere. So let's not become so cynical that we throw in the towel on this process. In terms of what people can do, human nature is human nature. And I failed, and I've been very clear and very direct about that. My flaws have been very publicly made evident. And I did what I thought was proper, so I would only say to other people who want to get into this, there are temptations, there are risks. Be smarter than I was.
A lot of what you've been talking about with respect to the American economy and the government response relates to various levels of regulation. Do you have any concern that the amount of regulation that we have piled onto the American capital markets are making us less competitive in the world?
Yes and no. In other words, I'm always fearful of don't regulate us or else we'll go move our bank to London, because that is a descent to the lowest common denominator, just the same way Merrill was saying, we're not as bad as our competitors. So you have to be careful of that. On the other hand, I've said this pretty clearly as well, it isn't always the case that we need more regulation, we just need to enforce the existing rules. In other words, simple anti-fraud provisions needed to be enforced. Simple rules against lying to one's customers, simple rules about observing fiduciary obligations. We have most of the rules in place that we need to make things run properly. It's a matter of enforcing them rather than always building a new rule to create a Rube Goldberg. Just enforce what's there and probably will be okay.
You were talking about the... Actually, you didn't talk about it tonight, but you've written recently about the AIG bailout and the transparency of the government in the investigation, and perhaps I think you've called for the release of AIG emails to the public. I wondered if you could say a little bit more about that and also talk about any concerns you might have about the privacy of information and whether this information getting out in the public more broadly can be used for mischief today.
Two issues. I mean, they're related, but let me deal with them as separate issues. I have a unique relationship with AIG. I kind of feel as though I was start off tilting at windmills when we brought our civil case alleging all sorts of accounting fraud at AIG and was met with hue and cry and from the financial world, how can you say anything negative about AIG? It's the best company in the world. And I said, you don't understand, this is the center of the web. And I would go home at the end of the day and say to my wife, you know, I feel as though I'm stuck in this web and this giant black widow is about to kill me, but I'm telling you there's something wrong with this company. And AIG was the vortex, it really was. And the reason I've called for the release of all the AIG emails is twofold. One, I do believe if we follow those emails, and what I analogize to is an open source investigation, I said release them to the public, let everybody bring their investigative skills, thousands of journalists, lawyers, whomever, to parse them and find out what was going on. The reason we need to do that is because it was the center. The reason we can do it, this isn't IBM, which is really a private company, we own AIG. We have made a $180 billion investment in AIG. As the shareholders, we can say, we want to know. So it's sort of, we are in a position to tell the three, technically the three trustees appointed by the Treasury Department, to tell the board of directors, release the emails, redact them all the private stuff, take away all the legal privilege stuff, but let us understand the financial transactions between AIG and Goldman, AIG and all their counterparties. The counterparty payments at 100% on the dollar, I wrote about this last March, I said this was the greatest scam in history. Absolutely outrageous. It was, and, you know, it swamped in importance the bonus issue. The bonus issue was a problematic issue, but the counterparty payments was fundamentally wrong. And this is when I really, I think, finally lost it with Geithner. We give all this money through AIG to the counterparties, and we take stock in the worthless shell rather than even taking stock in the recipient of the money. I mean, this is, you know, deal-making 101, so I said, these guys don't get it. This is something that we should really dig into. It's beginning to happen a year later than it should have, but so be it. The privacy issue is real. I mean, we're living in a world where, you can't do anything that isn't seen, heard, listened to, followed, traceable from the, easy pass in your car to every every stroke of a computer key. And that raises issues in a world where we do believe in privacy. And I think we've got to do something to define what the parameters of privacy can and should be.
I had a number of questions from the audience about what's happened to organized crime. It used to be such a big topic, and it seems to have disappeared off our domestic agenda. You would be a person who would know. What's going on there?
Well, look, it looks different. Now we wear pinstripes. I mean, it's, right? I was kind of lucky in a twisted way. I was a prosecutor, and Mary mentioned I prosecuted a number of organized crime cases. They were kind of fun to do in a twisted way because it was the moment when, for whatever reason, Hollywood was focusing on it. The TV series were all about it. And there was a certain grandeur about it. It was fun. Organized crime will always be there. But we've gone through what I call the white-collarization of organized crime. The smart organized crime figures realized the people who really make money are the folks who get together, create a monopoly, take over an industry, increase prices by 10 or 15%, and do very nicely. That beats by a long margin running a loan sharking operation on the street corner, beating somebody over the head with a baseball bat, because when you hit somebody over the head with a baseball bat, the cop comes and arrests you. When you create a monopoly, it looks like white-collar crime, and they say, we don't fuss with that. And so that's what happened. In the case I prosecuted involving the Gambino family and trucking in the garment district, they'd formed a clever cartel. And we prosecuted them under the New York State antitrust law, which actually preceded the Sherman Act. That's what we did. So what we call traditional organized crime, the sort of organized crime you would see in the Godfather movies, really went through that transformation now. But let's not kid ourselves. Organized crime is there. It moves in terms of ethnicity. It moves in terms of geography. It moves in terms of subject matter. It will always be there, but there really was this what I call white-collarization.
You know, you've touched on it a number of times tonight, but if you could just say directly to Congress what needed to be done to fix Wall Street from a congressional perspective, what would you tell them?
Well, oh, wow.
Imagine.
We have an hour?
No, you have seven minutes.
7 minutes. That's still a lot. But first, I would say and this is more an email to the executive as well as to the congressional side of Pennsylvania Avenue, I would say put people in charge of the U.S. Attorney's offices, the OCC, FDIC, OTS, and other regulatory bodies who really believe in hardcore regulation, meaning leverage ratios, soundness of loans, fundamentally redo the rating agencies, fundamentally cabin what banks can and should do, go back to a world where banks do what they're supposed to do, go back to a world where banks compete with one another rather than merging Bear Stearns into Morgan Chase overnight just because it facilitates a transaction. Go back to a much more atomized banking system akin to what Paul Volcker, Mervyn King, and even Nick Brady, the Bush administration Treasury Secretary, have been writing about recently. We need that financial structure and then empower prosecutors to go out and find fraud, and most of the problems will disappear.
You're listening to the Commonwealth Club of California radio program, and our guest today is Elliot Spitzer, former governor and attorney general for the state of New York. What are your thoughts about the failed medical reform effort that's gone on the last couple of months, and what do you think we should do about that?
Well, look, I, from my experience as governor, can tell you that you come in with what you think is a mandate. You have unbelievable expectations, both personally and created by the media, and then you run into this brick wall called the legislature and all the people who disagree with what you want to do. This is, and we've seen this over and over again with healthcare. I think now it is fair to say that healthcare probably should not have been the front and center issue that the president tried to confront this year. We have crises that are more urgent in terms of jobs, in terms of the structure of our economy, and I wish he had focused on job creation from the get-go. Having said that, do we need healthcare reform? Of course we do. We need to make sure that everybody has health insurance. That should be viewed as a fundamental right in this nation. But the way we went about it began to appear as though the president and the White House every day were open to making a deal with anybody who knocked on the front door of the White House. And so it lost the principled articulation that was necessary to maintain public support. And again, I'm the last person who should be giving advice to President Obama about communication, but the fact of the matter is I don't think most of us in this room could say and articulate the 3 points or the 4 points or the 5 points that were the centerpieces of his healthcare reform at a principled level. What was it he was trying to accomplish? And if we don't know that, an audience that is paying somewhat more attention, then clearly the sense of urgency and political capital that he needed to get it done was going to dissipate. So I wish he had been more forceful in that regard. I wish he had used, when he came into power, he had both houses of Congress. He had an overwhelming majority in each. That is when he had to be Lyndon Johnson.
One of the questions is that America loves a rebirth story, especially after a mea culpa. Will you go back to elected politics, and what's next for Elliot Spitzer?
Look, let me say real clearly, I love doing what I'm doing. I'm teaching, I'm writing, getting to spend time in a family business that my dad built, and he's 85, about to be 86, so I get to spend time with him. And that is wonderful. I have the notion of running for office anytime in the near future is absolutely not on the horizon. It is, as I said, it's a wonderful, rewarding, spectacular profession. And I obviously miss it, but it's not what I'm doing.
I know you're a big proponent of education. What do you think we need to do with public education, especially higher education in this country?
Well, look, one of the things that I really was trying to focus on as governor was the CUNY and the SUNY systems, which are the two higher institutions of public higher learning in the state of New York. Frankly, we used to say we want to be like the University of California system. that wasn't meant to be a laugh line, but it's and then I turned on the TV one night and I saw the students were rioting or doing something. I said, I'm not so sure I want to use this metaphor anymore. But we need, maybe it's North Carolina, Texas, there are some great institutions of public higher learning. What we need to do is first lay the foundation for that, and that begins with early literacy. That begins with a much more rigorous set of standards. I'm a big believer in standards, testing. I know everybody gets upset. You teach to the test and all that. Yes, you have to avoid that, but we need to be rigorous. You remember the movie Borat? I think it related to Kazakhstan. The fourth grade students in Kazakhstan exceed fourth grade students in the United States in math. Think about that. You know, Borat sort of was parody. You know, we all were thinking, look at them. This was listed in the Wall Street Journal a couple weeks ago. I looked at it and I said, this cannot be real. So we need to lay the foundation with much more rigorous, demanding educational standards, beginning in preschool, early literacy, demanding standards that go all the way up through higher education, and then get kids to go to college. And we need to fund higher education. We need to make sure that every kid knows these days, if you don't get a college degree, you will not be employed in a meaningful way.
Well, unfortunately, we've reached the point in our program where there's time for only one last question. So I'll take one from our audience. What would you like your legacy to be as you look back on your life and career?
Boy, I haven't thought about writing my epitaph. That's kind of a hard... I don't know if I want to answer that, but it's a, I guess I would say what I'd most like to think is that what I did when I was Attorney General helped to begin a more thoughtful conversation about what government could do, what government had to do to make sure that the public interest actually was pursued, and that the intersection between the private sector and government was based upon a set of principles that were more real and generated real value for the public. And that was not something that we had during the period from President Reagan's election through Alan Greenspan's tenure as the Fed chair. And I think now we're at a moment where we can bring that back into balance, and by doing so, redefine a social contract in this nation that needs to be redefined. So, thank you. Thank you.